So good afternoon all of you. I hope I'm audible and visible. And welcome to the next session of Let's Crack NEET PG with me, Dr. Cheshta Agarwal. Now you all are on the best online platform for the preparation of NEET PG, and that is Unacademy. Unacademy can be easily downloaded from the App Store. Once you download the app, you need to have two things. Download the app and get your category, that is NEET PG. Once you download your category NEET PG, you have two options. One is free classes and another is paid. Free classes are special classes, while paid are the plus and iconic. Plus give you a daily live access, structured course, live test and unlimited access to the platform. And iconic, in addition to Unacademy, give you an access to prep ladder. We have a new batch which is the NEET PG test and analysis batch, started on 24th. Now in this batch we have a morning and an evening test analysis, which is very important for your upcoming entrance examination. Whether you have done your preparations from your own notes, any coaching centers, anything, this batch will help you revise whatever you have run with daily test, and it includes around 12 grand test, which is the need of an hour. So grand test is something which you all have to focus. It help you analyze on your weaker topics, and whatever you feel subject is not going well for you, you can just cope up with a new revision strategy. We have another batches, that is the target next batch, and we have a professional year batch 4. We have a focus FMG batch course starting on 28th, and the derma classes will start on 16th. This will be mainly directing towards the FMG December. Okay, I'm very sorry for this. Very sorry. Yes. Now we have a limited time period offer, and that is for preparation of the NEET PG, and that is a 2-month subscription. If you subscribe to Unacademy using the referral code CHESHTA10 and get a 2-month subscription of Unacademy, it is worth ₹67.50. I request all my dear students to please be a part of Unacademy by taking this limited time period 2-month subscription if at all you are targeting NEET PG. We have a very limited time period offer of iconic revised prices. We have 4-year subscriptions. We have 4-year subscriptions of 60,000 or 75,000, and we have these are the price list. Longer the subscription, lesser will be the per month cost. For NEET PG, I would recommend a 2-month. For FMG, I would recommend a 3-month. And for next pattern, I would recommend 12 month of either plus or 12 month of either iconic. Whatever you take, in the end, you have to put a referral code. In the end, you have to put a referral code, and that is Cheshta, that is my name. And 10. I request everyone to please become a part of an academy family. We also have a bug bounty program where all the learners can report any inappropriate content and claim their prizes. Now today we have a one-liner series starting with the questions straight away. We'll try to discuss as much as questions possible. Investigation of choice for epidermolysis bullosa, which is a mechanobullous disorder. Anyone? The correct answer here is electron microscopy. Dr. Tina, Salman, Chetna, Sangeeta. In epidermolysis bullosa, which is a mechanobullous disorder, you have no autoantibodies, and when there is no autoantibodies, the DIF becomes negative. the DIF becomes negative. I request all of you, I request Raj Ravi, Madhu, Chetna, Sangeeta, Tina, Salman, if you are targeting this NEET PG entrance examination, please go ahead and get an Unacademy subscription of 2 months, which is the shortest subscription available. And this can help you crack the exam better, because this is something which is very important. If DIF is negative, you will not use DIF for investigation, and the next best option available will be electron microscopy. Through electron microscopy, you can exactly tell where is the level of cleft. So level of cleft, three types of epidermolysis bullosa. In EB simplex, the level of cleft is intraepidermal, while in the patients of EB junctional and EB dystrophic, it is subepidermal. Fine, clear all of you? So this is a very, very important point for all of you. The next question. Inverted saucer shape lesions is found in inverted saucer shape lesion is found in. Amazing. The answer is B.B. Hansen. And what is inverted saucer? You have sloping margin and punched out center. Sloping margin and punched out center, also known as Swiss cheese appearance. Also known as Swiss cheese appearance. Very, very important. Very important. Also known as Swiss cheese appearance. Inverted saucer shaped lesions found in. The answer becomes option number 2. Next question. Anyone? Very nice, Madhu, Tina, Naveen, Salman. Anyone? Please remember, whenever there is relapse of leprosy, which can be because of stopping the treatment, that is defaulter, or you have resistance against multi-drug therapy. In both these conditions, you have relapse of leprosy. And in relapse of leprosy, the patient presents with a classical clinical feature of asymptomatic multiple 5 to 50 subcutaneous nodules all over the body. Patient presents with 5 to 50 subcutaneous nodules all over the body, which is asymptomatic, and this is known as histioid leprosy. The correct answer becomes option number 2, because it is the nodular form where you have a lot of subcutaneous nodules distributed all over the body. What is the classical histopath? Anyone? Histopathological examination will give you, anybody can tell me what are the different cells? You have foamy cells, or you have cells which are present, spongiform cells, which are present in storiform pattern. The characteristic feature, they are spongiform cells with the storiform pattern, and there is presence of large number of acid fast bacilli in the form of groups known as globi. That is all about the histioid Hansen. Anyone? Riedle-Joplin classification does not include. Riedle-Joplin classification of leprosy does not include. Very nice, amazing, amazing. So Riedle-Joplin classification of leprosy, it includes the tuberculoid leprosy, the lepromatous leprosy, and the borderline pole. Indeterminate leprosy is a part of Indian classification. This is the part of Indian classification. So the correct answer becomes option number 3. Now please tell me the answer of next question. Sujit, Salman, Hemendra, Deepthi, Shrinjaya, Madhu. Please tell me the correct answer. Amazing. So, in vitiligo, melanocytes are absent. Now, what is the mechanism of vitiligo? Vitiligo is a multifactorial condition. The most accepted mechanism is autoimmunity, where T lymphocytes are directed against the melanocytes, and it leads to damage and loss of melanocytes. Another is neurogenic theory. It says that there are some mediators released by the nerves, and these mediators will cause damage to the melanocytes, and that is why you see a different variant which is called as segmental. So the nerve releases some toxins which damage the melanocytes, called as neurogenic theory. Next, oxidative theory. It says that lot of oxidative stress factors develops, and this ultimately causes damage to the melanocytes. Next is melanocytography. Cytography. मिलेनोसाइटोट्रॉफी, now what does it tell? It tells that the melanocytes are very loosely attached at the stratum basale, and whenever you have any trauma to the skin, the melanocytes get dislodged and they are then ultimately killed, giving rise to depigmented patches. Among all these theory, there is one thing common, and that is damage to melanocyte, and this damage to melanocyte is responsible for white color of the vitiligo patch. Next question. Very nice. Now, what is porphyria cutanea tarda? We have discussed few days back. PCT is a pure cutaneous type of porphyria. But there are few points I request all my dear students to remember. The first point is, it is an acquired condition. And that is why in the patients of PCT, the symptoms occurs in the adult life. But in CEP or congenital erythropoietic porphyria and protoporphyrias, both of them are seen since birth, because that is the congenital disorder. This is the acquired condition. Second, it occurs because of liver damage. When any condition causes liver damage, it causes increase in inhibitors, and this inhibitor will cause inhibition of uroid enzyme. So what are the conditions which causes liver damage? Alcohol, hepatitis C, hemochromatosis. So the answer becomes all of the above. Understood, all of you? Very simple and easy questions. All of the above causes liver damage, increase in the inhibitors, and then there is subsequent damage to the uroid enzyme. Next. Very nice, all of you. So pseudoporphyrias, what do you mean by pseudoporphyrias? Clinical feature resembles porphyria, means they have presence of bulla and scarring over the exposed part. But why it is called as pseudoporphyrias? Because there is no heme synthesis defect. Because in porphyria, you tend to see heme synthesis defect. Here, there is no heme synthesis defect. And that is why it is called as pseudoporphyria. The correct answer becomes all of the above. Next question. Hemendra, Tina, Sujit, Raj Ravi, Salman, Shrinjiya, Sangeeta. Anyone can answer this question? Very nice. Now, what is pinch purpura? It is a spontaneous purpura which occurs in the soft tissue without trauma, like periocular skin. It is a very classical feature of primary systemic amyloidosis. Very classical feature of primary systemic amyloidosis. Because of accumulation or infiltration of the bone marrow by the abnormally folded protein or amyloid protein, you have thrombocytopenia, and this thrombocytopenia will give rise to spontaneous or non-traumatic purpura. So that is the reason, and the correct answer is primary systemic amyloidosis, which is seen very frequently in the patients having multiple myeloma. The primary systemic amyloidosis seen in the patients of multiple myeloma. The next question is on your screen. Please answer this one. Please answer this question, all of you. I want all my students to please answer this question. Anyone, what is Binkley spot, and it is also known as? So Binkley spot is the name given to diabetic dermopathy. What is diabetic dermopathy? Anyone can tell me what is diabetic dermopathy? In a long standing diabetes, what happens in a long standing diabetes, you have abnormality in the blood vessel wall. It becomes leaky. It comes out of the blood vessels. This red blood cells which come out of the blood vessel, it will start accumulating itself. It will start accumulating itself inside the skin, and when it start accumulating inside the skin, it causes atrophy or necrosis of that part, and this is called as diabetic dermopathy or Binkley spot. It is also known as diabetic shin spot. And how does it appears? It appears brown, atrophic, present either on the shin, or it can also be seen over the forearm. So wherever there is friction, you can see presence of Binkley spot. The next question. Anyone? Yeah, it is brown and atrophic. The most common cutaneous manifestation seen in the patients of end-stage renal disease, pigmentation, pruritus, half and half nail or pseudoporphyria. Now here remember that the commonest, all these four are the features. All these four things are seen in the patients of, all these four things are seen in the patients of chronic or end-stage renal disease, but among the options provided, the commonest being pruritus. The commonest, Surya, commonest is pruritus. It is not pigmentation, not half and half nail, not pseudoporphyria. The commonest is pruritus. Coming to the next change. Please tell me the answer of this question, all of you. Please tell me the answer of this question. Skin changes in hypothyroidism is characterized by all except anyone. Skin changes in hypothyroidism are characterized by all except anybody. Very nice, Dr. Tina, Sujit, Vasima, Damari, very nice. Now, in hypothyroidism, you see sign of Hertogi, that is loss of lateral one third of eyebrow. You see orientiasis cutis, which is the yellowish hue seen in the patients of hypothyroidism due to deposition of beta carotene in the skin. You see dry coarse skin, but palmar erythema or increased BMI, it is a feature of hyperthyroidism. It's a feature of hyperthyroidism. So skin changes in hypothyroidism is characterized by all except. Theek hai ji? Done, clear. Please give me a quick thumbs up if you have understood this. Please give me a quick thumbs up. Chal, good, fine. Please answer this question, all of you. Anyone? Commonest micronutrient deficiency in a patient of eating disorders. Very nice. The answer is zinc. Zinc is the commonest micronutrient deficiency which is seen in the patients of eating disorders like anorexia nervosa, bulimia nervosa. They tend to have very, very deficient intake of zinc, giving rise to the features of zinc deficiencies, which have associated vitamin A deficiency, because zinc is acting as a carrier for transport of vitamin A. So if zinc is absent, then obviously vitamin A would be absent. Okay, so that would be the feature. Which of the following is not the causative agent? Please tell me the answer of this question, all of you. I can see a lot of students. Tina, Raj Ravi, Vasima, Atira, Shrijiya, Rivalika. A very, very easy one-liner question. Amazing. So, if you remember, I think day before yesterday or maybe 2 days before the today's session, we have discussed the etiology of acne. What was the etiology of acne? First was hypercornification of follicular opening. That was the first thing. What was the second? Increase in P. acne. Third was recruitment of the inflammatory mediators. And the fourth was increase in the androgen. An androgen increase can be seen in the patients like polycystic ovarian disease. Now, I have never discussed anything about the food. We do have food agent which causes acne, but they are not oily food. They are high glycemic index food or milk or milk product. Both these conditions causes increase in insulin-like growth factor 1. And this increase in insulin-like growth factor 1 will cause increase sebum production, and there will be increase acne. there will be increased acne formation. Clear, all of you? Please give me a quick thumbs up if this point is clear. Next question. Which of the following is a specific lesion of acne vulgaris? Specific lesion of acne vulgaris. Amazing, nice, very well done. Raj, Ravi, Vasima, Salman, Dr. Tina, Damari, everybody is right. Which of the following is the specific lesion for acne vulgaris? The correct answer here is option number 3. The correct answer is option number 3. Comedone, which is either open or closed. Now, what is this open and closed comedone? If this is the skin and we have hair like this and you have presence of a sebaceous gland. Now what happens? The sebaceous gland will produce a lot of sebaceous material. This is sebaceous material which comes out like this and it usually gets spread onto the skin. But because of the obstruction to the follicular outflow, what happens? The sebaceous material will start accumulating inside. Now when they start accumulating inside, they will appear white in color and this is called as closed comedone. And in few conditions, what happens? There is a slight opening. There is a slight opening which left here. There is a slight opening which remains here. And through which the air enters and cause oxidation of the sebum, making it black. So black comedone is seen when there is a slight opening remain in the follicular obstruction because of oxidation through the air in the atmosphere, the sebum get oxidized and turn it into black color. So open comedones are actually blackheads and closed comedones are actually whiteheads. Theek hai ji? So please remember this point, very very important for your entrance examination. Next question. Please answer this question, all my dear students. Which of the following is subepidermal disease? Darius disease, bullous impetigo, pemphigus foliaceus or bullous pemphigoid? Fine. So the correct answer here is option number 4. Darius disease is suprabasal split. Bullous impetigo is subcorneal split. Pemphigus foliaceus is also subcorneal split. So all these three becomes intraepidermal. While bullous pemphigoid becomes subepidermal. Because here you have affection of basement membrane zone component. You have affection of bullous pemphigoid antigen 1 and 2, which is the part of basement membrane zone. And that is why the correct answer becomes option number 4. Next question. Rarest variety of pemphigus is? Rarest variety of pemphigus foliaceus is? Very nice, amazing all of you, very well done. The correct answer is pemphigus vegetans. Now pemphigus vegetans is a variant of pemphigus vulgaris. How it differs? Clinically, you will see presence of vegetative growth on the flexures. You have vegetative growth on the flexures in the patients of pemphigus vegetans. That is why it is called as vegetans, because of the vegetative growth. And yes, you are right, Salman. The common one is vulgaris, pemphigus vulgaris. The word vulgaris anywhere is the commonest. Next question. Which drug is most commonly implicated in drug-induced pemphigus? Very nice, Athira, Tina, Salman, Vasima, Bhavesh. Amazing, all of you, amazing. So, which drug is most commonly implicated in drug-induced pemphigus? The answer is penicillamine. Now, what is the mechanism of action? In drug-induced pemphigus, you see biochemical interaction. You see biochemical interaction. So, the thiol group of drug will interact with the thiol group of desmosome or desmoglein, and both these have a biochemical interaction. Both these have a biochemical interaction which causes abnormality in the shape, giving rise to features similar to pemphigus. So please remember, there are many drugs like penicillamine, penicillin, there's a long list. But the commonest is penicillamine. You don't have any autoantibody. It is purely because of biochemical interaction. There is no autoantibody formed. Next question. Which of the following is the commonest association of paraneoplastic pemphigus? Any one of you? Can you answer this one? Very nice. The correct answer is commonest. Vaseem, I am asking you the commonest. All four are associated with paraneoplastic, but the commonest is non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Now here what happens? How does paraneoplastic pemphigus differs from pemphigus vulgaris? In pemphigus vulgaris, you have antibodies against intercellular adhesive molecule, desmosome. And what part of desmosome? Desmoglein. In paraneoplastic pemphigus, along with autoantibodies to desmoglein, they have autoantibodies to plakin group, like desmoplakin, envelopplakin, periplakin, etc. So all these together will cause a more dreaded skin features, which is recalcitrant to treatment. Please remember the correct answer of this question is option number 3. I hope this is clear to all my dear students. Please give me a quick thumbs up. Please give me a quick thumbs up. Fine. Let's move to the next question. Which among the following is the most common type of psoriatic arthritis? Which among the following is the most common type of psoriatic arthritis? Classical arthritis nutilans, asymmetrical oligoarthritis, or symmetrical polyarthritis? Which among the following is the most common type of psoriatic arthritis? Amazing. The classical answer is asymmetrical oligoarthritis. We have total 5 types: classical psoriatic arthritis, or classical rheumatoid arthritis like arthritis nutilans, asymmetrical, symmetrical, and then there is one more, that is DIP only. Among these 5, the asymmetrical oligoarthritis is the commonest, seen in majority of the patient. Now, can any one of you tell me how many patients of psoriasis develop arthritic features in their course, disease course? Anyone? How many patients in their disease course develops arthritis? Can any one of you answer this? Salman, Damari, Sujit, Vaseema, then we have Tariq, Dr. Tina. Can you tell me the answer of this question? Okay, so Salman is with the one answer. Anybody can, any other comments here, any other options? So yes, you are right in one point, that the percentage is very less, and it is around 5%. You can also call it as 5 to 10%, but towards the lower edge only. Okay, so the percentage of the patient developing psoriatic arthritis is very limited. And is very strong when you have an HLA B27 associated in a patient with psoriatic skin disease. Okay, ji? So remember, the ratio is 5 to 10%, more towards the 5%. You do not see a lot of patients with psoriatic arthritis in your day-to-day practice. Fine. Let's move to the next question. Hutchison syphilitic triad includes notched incisors, nerve deafness, interstitial keratitis, or Clutton joint. Amazing, very nice. Raj Ravi, Tina, Krishnai, Tarek, Bhavesh, very nice, amazing, amazing students, amazing. The correct answer is Hutchison syphilitic triad includes all except Clutton joint. It includes all except Clutton joint. Clutton joint is what? There is swelling of the knee joint, and because of that swelling, there is pain, and the patient will not move because of pain. And this will give a pseudo-paralysis effect, which is called as pseudo-paralysis of Parrot. Which is called as pseudo-paralysis of Parrot. Which of the following is the earlier eruption of secondary syphilis, or which is not the earliest eruption? Except, they have asked except. Dr. Sameer, Dr. Tina, early eruption of secondary syphilis are all except intensely pruritic, papular, maculopapular, symmetrical, or pleomorphic. Very nice, very nice. You will see all type of lesion, but you will never see intensely pruritic lesions. So I can see a few students who have not given me the correct answers. Please remember, all of you, you will never see vesicles. you will never see vesicles and you will never see itching. Other than this, a patient of secondary syphilis can present with any sort of manifestation. Other than vesicles or other than itching, you can see any sort of presentation. It can be maculopapular, symmetrical, pleomorphic, etc., etc. But never vesicle, never itching. Otherwise, it is a great imitator, can present with any sort of clinical presentation. Next question. What is Miliaria crystallina? Yes, very nice. Okay, so Miliaria crystallina is a disorder of sweat gland. So let's have a diagram drawn. This is your skin. Epidermis, dermis, hypodermis. Okay, ji. You have a hair, very beautiful hair like this. You have three type of glands. One, two, and three. Can you name them? Can you name each of them? Number A, number B, and number C. Which is gland number A? Sebaceous gland. B is apocrine gland. And what is C? C is eccrine gland. Both apocrine and eccrine are the part of sweat gland. Understood all of you till here? Please give me a quick thumbs up if you all are clear. Now, what happens sometimes, maybe because of heat, maybe because of environmental conditions, there is obstruction which happens to the duct. If the obstruction occurs at the opening of the eccrine gland to the outside environment, this is called as Miliaria crystallina, where the obstruction is at the level of stratum corneum. If it occurs somewhere here at the layer stratum malpighian, it is called as Miliaria. What does it call as? Miliaria rubra. And if it occurs at dermoepidermal junction, it is known as Miliaria profunda. Understood all of you? So depending upon the level of obstruction, you have Miliaria crystallina, rubra, and profunda. And here the answer is Miliaria crystallina, which is the example of the obstruction at stratum cornea level. Please answer the next question. Eccrine sweat glands are absent in. Very nice, Salman, Dr. Tina, Raj Ravi, Hemendra, Dr. Sameer, Sujit. Amazing, all of you, amazing. Wasima, very nice, all of you. The correct answer is mucosa. You will never see presence of eccrine sweat glands on the lips, clitoris, or external auditory meatus. So these are some of the sites where you never see eccrine type of sweat glands. Next question. which is the reliable test for chancroid detection? Which is the reliable test for chancroid detection? Which is the reliable test for chancroid detection? Amazing. I can see your answers. Pritya Rishini, Bhavesh, Dr. Sameer, Vaseem, Sujit, Dr. Jay, Salman. Very nice. The correct answer is gram smear. And what do you see in gram smear? You will see a classical school of fish appearance, which is also known as rail road track appearance. Theek hai ji? Fine, clear. So with this, we are done with the today's session. I hope you have enjoyed this session, a very interesting one. Please subscribe to this YouTube channel, that is Let's Crack NEET PG. For taking subscription of Unacademy, use my code CHESTA10. I would recommend a 2-month subscription. That would be enough for your NEET PG as well as FMG. Please take it now, because this is a very limited time period offer. You may not have that in the next month. So try to take a 2-month subscription, revise the theory in detail. Don't forget to press the bell icon to get the further notification, and please follow.